So now you're going to watch the video of my conversation with filmmaker Kiran Rao, which I recorded at her studio recently. Kiran Rao is a very acclaimed filmmaker who made films like Dhobi Ghat and recently much talked about super hit film Lapata Ladies. A small appeal that we are listener funded podcast, so please go to description box and find the links to support us. Now, since we are scaling up the podcast, we need your support more than ever. And yes, now you can also become the member of this channel, because the membership button is now also available. So please do check out all these features and the links. And now let's start this conversation in 3, 2, 1. So we can start actually. All right. So, Kiran Rao, welcome to Anurag Minus Verma podcast. How are you doing?
My absolute honor and privilege to be on this. I'm doing well, yeah. Really happy at this point with lots of the love I'm getting for the film.
Overwhelmed because of the reactions, expected this kind of a response?
I knew that people liked the film after Toronto. We did the first screenings at the film festival at Toronto, and the reactions were really warm and, you know, standing ovations. And audiences, I thought there were just one different because they're a film festival audience, perhaps also because they're just generous and, you know, want to come there wanting to love films. You know, that's the kind of festival it is. But, you know, we started showing it to media quite a bit earlier than we even started our promotions. We were getting really great feedback. We did promotions. We're getting very good feedback. But the box office was average to low. And I mean, I guess for a size of film like this with no stars, it's to be expected. But I didn't realize that the film would sustain and be in cinemas like it is even now.
You know, when I was in Jamia, like I went for the admission for this film course that they have there. And you are also from the same course. So I was there in 2011. And at that time, there was like, you look at the alumni of the institute, and that time, like, Kiran Rao is the alumni of this institute. So I remember that time. And obviously, I didn't get the admission. So that is a different thing. But how was your time at in that era? Which year was it?
I was there from 95 to 98.
95 to 98. So how was life of a cinema student back then?
You know, I came from a family where there wasn't much talk of cinema. I mean, it was all... I also came from an era when TV had just about made its entrance into my life when I was 7, 8 years old. And, you know, we saw cinema. We didn't go to the theater. We saw films that came on Sundays on TV. And, you know, I'm that generation in that sense. So I didn't really, apart from DD, East European films that came on DD way back.
East European?
Seriously? Yeah, because we were a kind of Eastern Bloc country then, right? And we had tie-ups, I suppose, with Russian television things like that. So we would get late night. Sometimes I would, you know, sneak in to watch late night black and white films from, I don't know, all over the Eastern Bloc, I suppose. But, you know, the popular Hindi films or national award winning films on Sundays in the evening and things like that. So my exposure to cinema was quite poor in that sense. I mean, I watched a lot more whatever came on TV, but also, I you know, books and theater and that kind of thing growing up. I didn't have much access. But when I realized I wanted to do something in the arts, I thought, I'm not sure what exactly it is. I know I love performance. I used to act in college. I know I love to write. I like music. I'm very, very interested in music and poetry, photography. So I was like, you know, maybe this is a space I can go into. And FTII just seemed like too long a commitment to make, because I had to also earn a living. I didn't come from a family which after college could support me for another 5 years, you know. So I applied to Jamia and got in. And it was incredible because actually I came like a completely open book. I had no reference points of cinema apart from a few things that I'd watched in school, I mean, growing up. So it was an introduction to cinema from all over the world, from different sort of formal traditions of cinema, documentary, experimental films. There was a chance to kind of have this discourse outside of, you know, did the film do well, which is all we are interested in these days, you know, talk about cinematic language, talk about techniques that they must have used. And I'm talking about masters, you know, through the French New Wave or the Japanese masters and things like that. So also what was then considered very new cinema, hybrid forms of documentary filmmaking and things like that, which was super, super interesting for me because it was all new. And documentary, which used to be just, you know, literally piece to camera kind of filmmaking, suddenly opened up. I was in Delhi. I was, you know, living in a place which got a lot of international cinema through the consulates operated. Yes. They used to have these weekends, you know, suddenly like...
American Center, German Center,
Swedish films are being shown.
You used to watch there?
Like I used to go at, you know, like on whichever, they used to sometimes have a weekend of film watching. Like I told you, IFFI used to happen in City Fort and things like that. Those were the kinds of ways we got to watch films from around the world and understand actually some sort of film history, where the moving image has come, you know. And I fancied myself like this great artistic filmmaker who would be able to make a film within 1 or 2 years of coming out of Jamia. I mean, no sweat, you know, that kind of confidence of somebody who knows the form. So it completely, I suppose, in some way ignited that interest in cinematic language. I continue to learn. I feel like I just about started my journey there. It gave me a great foundation, you know, to see where montage started. What, you know, like to watch Eisenstein or, you know, any of these kind of master, like, class filmmakers.
But that's what happened. Did you also make any short films, documentary
we
before
did.
The feature film?
In Jamia was when I made some shorts. There was a couple of other, you know, sort of for NGO kind of things that I did after I came out. But I didn't make any short narrative films of my own. I didn't make anything actually until I made Dhobi Ghat. That was like my first ever anything.
And Dhobi Ghat also has a very different kind of language as compared to your recent film. It is more, there is more like playing with the form and experimentation. And there is also, it's more of a personal expression in a way. So at that time, your idea of cinema, was it different? Was it more influenced by the masters that you have seen? Like, how was it during making Dhobi Ghat?
I do think that I kind of, it was the a little bit of that student in me also making a film, testing my legs in a sense, you know, wanting to experiment and play. And, you know, I was so interested in ways of seeing and perspectives when it came to the city and ways of seeing the city, what the city as a visual construct is. I was very interested in trying different things. But I also wanted to make a film that could in some way be, you know, accessible theatrically to people. So it needed a story and narrative. And, you know, while I wrote it as four fairly fluid, interconnected stories, I wrote it also in a way where literally the timelines could be interchanged on the edit table, which was why I took very long to edit it. It was certainly far more personal than this film is. You know, this film, Lapata Ladies, was really made for an audience. And I, while I was making it, was also acutely aware that I wanted to, you know, while I was making it for a broad audience, make it my own, somehow marry the two.
Like your more of a philosophy of life and things you believe in.
And also stylistically make it my own.
In that sense, I was also curious to know that this whole idea of, let's say, even in the film school also, they teach us, like, even in the art theories, there is an idea of swabhav. Like, what is a swabhav in your film? Like, what is the personality? And is it matching with your personality in that sense? Like, any kind of expression that you're creating. So it is considered that when you reach at the right swabhav, then the artistic, you know, journey starts, because then you see your personality and the kind of things you make. There is a merger in that sense. But reaching to a certain form that this is something that I want to make, or this is a form which speaks more to me. So do you also think about that, like the form, like which is the exact form that I want to try my things, or like how do you think about these
That's super interesting, actually, because I do think about it. And honestly, I feel while I was making this film, One of the reasons I knew I wanted other people to write it, while I knew what I wanted to say and what I wanted to bring in, I knew that actually the kind of narrative conventions that writers of a certain kind of mainstream film are well versed with, I am not. You know, and I come from a school where I want to experiment, I want to, you know, kind of... I don't like to say things too much. I want to sort of underplay or underwrite or under-dialogue things. Whereas films don't necessarily, are not necessarily better for that, you know. So I'm perhaps always putting on some sort of an artistic hat when I'm writing, which a writer doesn't need to do at all. They write more because the story demands it. And I feel like now, I felt even though Lapata Ladies isn't in that sense a personal film in the same way that Dhobi Ghat is, it's closer to my, possibly my swabhav. Since, I mean, it's a very interesting idea which I hadn't thought of earlier, but it is because I feel like it gave me, because it was saying things that I wanted to say, it was saying it well because there were great writers involved, and it allowed me as a person who mostly wants to work with performers, with the visual language, with sound, with music, it gave me the freedom to do that in the way I would want. So the same script could have been made very differently by somebody else, right? But because when you look at the dialogues, they're very, very commercial dialogues, you know, and could have been a very grandstanding sort of way of saying each of those dialogues. But I felt like I could make it mine.
So in fact, this is also an interesting thing to explore, that since you are in Bombay and a very well-known popular figure, then the kind of the script that you get would be like so many throughout the day, or like throughout the year, throughout the month. Then among those kind of a script, how do you choose that this is the one I want to invest my 4 year, 5 year, or whatever the time it takes? So that whole idea of curation becomes very important.
Mm.
Because sometimes something seems very interesting for, let's say, 2-3 days or months, and then you realize, no, it's not going to work out, maybe in the long run. So that choosing that this is the thing that I want to, you know, go with for next, or that kind of a conviction, which sometimes works, sometimes doesn't work also. That's the whole nature of filmmaking is. So how does that curation, that choice that, yeah, this is something I want to invest my 4 years?
I think that's that comes with some sort of, I don't know, it's instinctive. It has to be instinctive, because that initial spark of excitement that you get when you hear an idea, if it stays with you long enough, then it's one of those that you want to see through to making it. You know, I feel like there's no real science to it. With stories that I've been trying to write myself, The stories are interesting for me because of what they potentially are going to talk about and the characters that are in the story. But I've never found perhaps the right sort of structure and writing tools that I personally lack, I feel, to make them. But I'm still interested in those stories, so I'm hoping to make them. So I feel when it's... You're right, because it takes really long to make a film. And many of these projects kind of fall by the wayside because they don't, in some ways, accrete the best kind of talent into that project, you know. So there are lots of my stories that I've written, which I'm excited about, but I feel I'm not able to sort of attract the right writer for the project. I've experimented with one or the other, and it just hasn't worked out. And it's not necessarily because the idea is weak, but I feel like films... in some way act as, I mean, good ideas, when they are magnetically strong, or we are just lucky, you tend to find the right cast and crew to make films like Lapata Ladies. You know, we actually managed to get the right writers, I managed to cast the right people. You know, at each stage, the kind of challenges are different. And at each stage, you could sort of drop the ball. So it's a very long process, but that initial idea needs to kind of imprint itself and be exciting to you. And usually it's something to do with the human condition and, you know, the world we've created for ourselves, you know. So because I'm interested in those things, the ideas generally tend to stick on.
Also, this is one question that I like very curious to understand from different filmmakers. Is filmmaking fun.
It is fun.
It's like the process, fun. But the whole process seems so cumbersome.
It is,
to create, to make it, and then there is some output.
Yeah.
And there is a possibility that that output may be good. Sometimes it may be good. It may not perform well. Sometimes, you know,
It could be anything.
But the whole process of making the film, there are people who enjoy it. There are people who said that we are cursed to do it. Like, we don't have any choice as an artist. Yeah. We have to express. So we have to do it. So filmmaking, even in that whole, like the form of expression, is one of the most resource heavy thing as compared to, let's say, poetry, you know, which is very easy. You can write the, not easy in that sense, but in the resources, it's very easy. Like painting.
Or stand up or something.
Painting or, like in different forms are not that resource. But filmmaking is, it's like so much of, managerial things, so much of...
People management, resources. No, fully agree, because it can be a nightmare, honestly. Because you're managing egos at the end of the day. So many different creative people. And you're managing money. So it's also commercially a giant risk compared to any other art form that we know. Like, you know, modern art form. So I think... I mean, there are certain sort of phases of filmmaking that are the most fun. At least for me, prep and shoot is the most fun. Like, I can go without sleeping for 3 months
Seriously?
To just make a movie. I would
most do it. Because most filmmakers like editing part, because when it's over,
it's the hardest time for me.
Okay.
It always takes me the longest. I mean, even this film, it took me a year and a half almost to have a cut that I was really happy with. So, I mean, it's not like I was editing right through. We were waiting. We also had a Lal Singh release in the middle. And there was like all kinds of reasons why it got delayed. But the shoot, the prep and the shoot is for me the most fun. I'd make a film only to do that, you know, if I could. Yeah.
Okay.
Because it's almost like you are, you know, that's the painting stage in some way. Because you're... choosing the scale of your canvas, you're choosing the colors of your, you know, your work. And I think editing is much more like, I don't know, cutting that painting down to fit a certain frame. I don't know. I find editing, and editing is where the film is really made. So it's the hardest part, because again, like killing your darlings and all the rest of it, you really have to put a stone on your heart and... you know, and then cut. And what we do actually, which you might find interesting, is that we test films. We test everything. We, as in Aamir Khan, at Aamir Khan Productions, Aamir had started this methodology of testing, which he's used for every single film of his, starting, I think, from Lagaan, which is now he's kind of honed to a pretty scientific method where, you know, it's not one group. It's we've tested 100 groups and above of 100 even. My film, I think, was tested on at least 50, 60 screenings.
Tested as in like before releasing you?
Long before we've locked the cut. Long after you have a cut that you're happy with is when testing begins. So it's not first cut.
Okay.
First cut you can test, so you can get some broad ideas from reactions. But once you even arrive at your what you think is your final cut is when also you test. And you keep testing at every stage of your cut so that you kind of arrive, you at least it gives you some sort of sense of whether, for instance, in a comedy, it's working. Is it funny? You know, for me, that was one of the sort of learnings I had from my first cut, was that it was about 25 minutes longer than the film you now see. And the jokes just weren't landing, you know. And it was, there were, you know, places where the film would just dip and... Lots of things come to light, you know, where the pace needs to be picked up, where audiences feel they've understood enough. Like, we've literally had to shave out lines within a monologue to arrive at the right, you know,
That's
at the right degree of how much to say. Because also this film has a lot of message in it, you know, in that sense. So how do you do it in a way where it's halka and it's natural and doesn't feel like, you know, some sort of...
So it's tested on... general public?
General public. Always general public. And different groups. So, for instance, I'll say, Anurag, call your family and 10 of your friends. So, we have we try to do a very wide range of age groups and people from different backgrounds. So, say, karigars from a friend's factory, or our own staff, our own friend circle, our CAs, CA friends, you know, our lawyers, lawyer friends. Aise karke alag alag groups. Building society, kisi ke building society.
Them, like after the
so film. after the screening, Amir generally starts with 3 questions. Did you just answer in a one word answer? So the first question is usually, if you had to categorize the film in just one of these 4 words, what would you call it? Bad, okay, good or very good. You can only choose one of these. The second was, would you recommend this film to your friends? That's the second. And the third was, would you like to see it again? And the fourth question now we've added is, would you pay to watch this in a cinema, or would you watch it on, would you wait for this on OTT? So these, it starts there, and people generally are quite honest about their answers. And when we then open up, they sometimes ask questions ki ye aisa kaise hua, mujhe theek samajh nahi aaya, you know, things that they might need to clarify. But slowly, slowly, when you let them talk, and it's then quite freewheeling, and you try not to defend it, and you just let them talk, then actually among themselves, someone says, ye scene thoda bore laga, then somebody else will say, nahi, 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 wo bahut acha tha, lekin ye theek nahi laga. And all of this is just stuff that we write down, but we don't necessarily change the cut basis these conversations.
But you get, like, the idea.
You get ideas, and over a bigger sort of sample size of 10 screenings, you kind of can tell, okay, a lot of people are feeling this about the film. And what can we do? Because they might say, just lambi lagi, 2 minute kaat do. As if it's like super easy ki 2 minute. Like lots of people. So many people say, thodi si lambi hai, aap 2-3 minute kaat do.
Yeah.
I heard from some OTT, some filmmaker actually got notes like, 30 seconds. Remove 30 seconds. Like, which, that, what?
Interesting. So, but this process is quite interesting to gaze
it. It really, in fact, especially because you're trying to communicate to a larger group of people, you know, to do it well before you've gotten to that theatre stage, you've got a sense, you know, of what you're doing.
Also, for example, this whole idea of humor and satire, especially when you're creating a satire on the village life, or let's say on the people who are, who don't come from the same kind of urban privileged setup like the director, then it becomes very tricky to, you know, go with the satire thing. Sometimes it is more easier to go through that atrocity kind of a genre, where you can easily do that easy kind of sympathy through filmmaking.
Correct.
But satire becomes very difficult in that sense, because there is also a very thin line. Maybe, you know, it can become very offensive, very like privilege gauge.
Yeah.
And then it can also become like laughing on their lifestyle. So there is a very thin line on making it very sensitively.
Yeah.
So that not just the urban audience who watches it get it, but also the people, maybe the village people or people from that section, they also watch it and they also like
feel
it.
Well represented in a sense. And it's,
so that kind of a sensitivity or that kind of a understanding, like, what were there kind of these kind of thoughts in your head, and how did you then navigate through them?
Well, there were these thoughts, because I'm an entirely a city girl in that sense. A lot of these experiences I would not have ever encountered, having been privileged enough to, you know, have education from the get-go, and English education and all the rest of it. So I was aware that I was, again, you know, representing or talking about a situation or a milieu that I am not from. But for one, the writers who were writing are all from that milieu. And the things that we wanted to talk about, we knew, you know, while we wanted to address them, we wanted to do it in a way that was laughing with characters, laughing, you know, or making fun of a situation in a self-deprecatory way, rather than at someone or, you know, sort of ridiculing any community or any group or, you know, anything. So I think having that sort of filter of empathy was always on, but we didn't want to make it sanctimonious and too goody-goody and none of that. Because honestly, anything that you satire in this country, because there's so much to be satirized, is a finger back at you in any case, whichever class you're from, wherever you're from, right? We are all part of this. So I didn't feel like I was othering anyone when I was making this film, for instance. So, and I think more than anything, it was important to cast the right kind of people who could, represent villages. Of course, this is a completely fictitious state, so I can't say represent being Bihari or... Yeah. But... in casting, if a lot of these characters either were from those backgrounds, from those areas, or were workshopped to have the sort of body language that they needed, the language, all the rest of it. So we tried to not, come like one outside gaze and do it a little bit more authentically, a little more believably.
First film we made was in 2011, then Lapata in 2023-24. So, like, how creative person deal with the gap, like such a long gap, because obviously filmmaking is a very difficult process and directors has to deal with these kind of gaps. Like, I'm also talking from my perspective as well, like, if I, like, people who are creating on social media, if they don't create it, let's say for a week or one day or 2 days, then they get very jittery and think that maybe they are losing the touch, maybe they are getting irrelevant. So there is a lot of fear, insecurity that one has to, every kind of artist has to deal with that.
True.
So, like, how was your phase in that sense? Like, where were you, like, very, how should I say, very eager to make film? Where is my film? Like, you wake up with those kind of thought ki abhi itna time ho gaya, where is my film?
Yeah, there were definitely moments of not just moments but like long periods when I felt like this sense of great failure and a sort of frustration that I wasn't going to be able to take it to the finishing line, because again, filmmaking is just such a collaborative team sport kind of work that without the right team players you just cannot get to the finishing line. That's how it works, and I just never had the right, I think, writing support that I needed for any of my ideas, and I think that did lead to a kind of lot of frustration. But I have to say that I was super privileged at the same time, because I did not have to make films for a living. Because a lot of people just don't have the luxury that I have to be, feel like, haan, now I've got it, ye kahani banani hai. They don't have that luxury. They have to just create every day. And if I may say, that is also a great impetus that, even if you don't do great work all the time, you're constantly creating. So I envied that sometimes, the freedom that people have when they're just doing it without overthinking, to some extent. But I spent 10 years, I really feel like, in some way, distilling a lot of the stuff that I was experiencing, a lot of what I was watching and reading and, sort of taking in from the world around me, what was happening, not just in, the art world, but politically what was going on. And also, sort of figuring out what I could do in the space of the visual arts, because I didn't want to make a film just to make a film, really. Beyond a point, that's why I've never made commercials or anything else, because it's not really about honing my craft and going out and, and luckily...
As in the ad films.
As in ad films. It's not been so much that for me. It's really been like, because I really wanted to work actually in the development space when I finished college. I did economics and the idea was to do developmental economics, work in the social sector and, do management kind of like entrepreneurial work in the social sector. But I realized I'm not like interested in that as much as I am in the arts. And I was wondering whether I could use the arts to do something in the development space, which is why I studied mass communication and not just cinema or, something super only creative. You know, the idea was, how do I get to a greater sort of wider audience? So I think what the time actually creatively was well used for me, because it helped me, one, find the right kind of story or vehicle to tell, you know, to maybe talk about things that I feel are important, but also slowly kind of understand that I have to use this privilege in a way that is lasting in some way, you know, in not just keep whatever making, which is also, you know, AKP, I've been part of also great films that we've been making in that sense. But personally, I wanted to make something that both creatively pushed my buttons and would in some way move the needle, you know.
And also this whole, like the, there was a time when...
that koyal's going crazy.
Very nice, but the sound. Like you have also seen the whole idea of, let's say, indie film, independent films also evolving over a period of time.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, earlier it has a very different kind of definition to it. It was made outside of the studio support. Like globally, it was considered independent cinema. And then there was many kind of experimental films at one point that were getting made. And even world over, there was some small collective of filmmaker who used to make these films, because there was a certain kind of ecosystem of these kind of a filmmaker, and also the ecosystem in terms of exhibition, because the spaces were a lot more as compared to right now. But over the years, especially after the OTT and everything, the whole idea of independent films also changed, because now the question is how much independence do a filmmaker also has in that particular kind of setup. So it is not like completely auteur kind of a thing that used to happen at one point of time. It became very different. So now there is also not that kind of a collective also of the filmmaker, if I'm not wrong, like the where there is a collective, they are also making films and they are exhibiting it in a different forms. Now it became a very specific, OTT-driven films or even the theater-driven kind of a film. So what is your assessment of this?
You know, I feel somehow when I was in film school, I felt like there was, you know, some scope to make artistic, independent, you know, non-mainstream in that sense, in the traditional sense of the word, films. And we used to only crib that, array single screens mein, you know, you need to give an MG and a minimum guarantee to rent the cinema to be able to put your films there. And now when I think about it, that's the most democratic thing in some ways, that I could rent a cinema just in 10 places and take the chance that the word of mouth will build over the week and the film will then run. We thought that the savior was going to be multiplexes, thinking, oh, then more screens, therefore more space for all of us. But that bubble burst soon enough when we realized, actually, for a country our size, we just don't have enough screens for even the big mainstream films that release. And then the next savior seemed to be OTT, which then we thought, okay, chalo, here a lot of our films will now be on OTT. But we've realized that that's not the case either. Because, again, simply because we are much greater in number, making more films perhaps than even OTT can buy, you know. And it's actually a strangely, which is why we were discussing earlier today, there's no model really, I think, to make independent films really independent of all these sort of models of distribution. So I'm not sure whether, even when you look at the West, sort of art house sales agents and distribution companies and people who would like perhaps buy smaller films like that, are actually only representing marquee names of big filmmakers who've either been to the top four film festivals in the world, or then, you know, in some way see some commercial value for them in other markets, you know. It's still extremely hard to make independent films. And I think the only potential way to recoup your money if you made an independent film is to go to several film festivals hoping that in each country you'll make some sales. That's been the model for independent filmmakers for the longest time, which is, you know, And often filmmakers will tell me that just the sales agent's fees and what they take out for what's called, you know, P&A, publicity marketing kind of costs, they hardly, you know, the recouping the actual cost of the film is really hard. And then they hopefully will finally get something when they go to OTT. So it's a, I don't see that there's any, in fact, great improvement. If anything, that's only been going down. I mean, the options for independent filmmakers.
Also, like the OTT also then, I mean, the filmmakers form then also get decided by the kind of form that are that are prevalent or that are trending on the OTT.
Exactly.
And then maybe filmmaker also then fears that maybe, like for example, let's say a film like Dhobi Ghat, which is more experimental, would, I'm assuming, would find it difficult on OTT platform.
You know, you won't believe it, Anurag. When we released in 2011, the film, UTV was, I think, the partner who helped us release it. And I think it was early days, of course, of multiplexes and everything else also. But UTV overseas sold streaming rights to Netflix in 2011.
There were no Netflix in India.
Because there was no Netflix here. And I used to, you know, because we didn't release in a very big way, obviously, overseas. It was a small, even though it was Amir in the film, it didn't get a very, very big release. So, I remember then being like, wow, look at this, yeah. Netflix pe log mujhe likh ke bol rahe hain ke, you know, wow, we saw your film in wherever it is, different countries, you know. So, I guess that was also a golden era of OTTs, when there wasn't that much from all over the world to choose from. In that sense, now I think it's also just competitive even for OTTs, you know, they're just perhaps not enough OTTs where, you know, where you can, how much can they also put into acquiring content, you know, so it just, it's a tricky thing. I mean, honestly, I don't see a way around it other than if you can get directly through pay-per-view to your audience for an independent filmmaker. You know, whether it's through Apple TV or paid for on YouTube or something, any way in which people can bypass, you can bypass this distribution networks and get to your audience, which is what every, and I think the biggest stumbling block, interestingly enough, isn't so much just the distribution, it's making audiences aware of the distribution, you know, that's the worst part, is that you could be releasing all over India and nobody's heard about it. Like you said, you hadn't heard of Lapata Ladies till reviews started coming. Yeah. So all those trips I made across the country, showing the film to people, nobody, I mean, literally the majority of people would not have even heard about it. Because traditional news sources or entertainment news sources, a lot of us just don't read anymore.
But you are very experienced in the whole marketing thing because you are making. So is it also that the films are changing? It's, like the whole idea is changing every year?
Yeah, marketing has completely changed. Film marketing was very, I mean, I'm talking, if we talk about Dhobi Ghat to now, film marketing is just, I don't know, it's not something that I can even claim to understand. You know, I don't know whether people in the business understand it that well either, because, you know, when you think of things that actually go viral or the kind of people perhaps who have great engagement and followers, you're like, how have I never heard of this person? They have like 30 million followers.
And the influencer thing in the
way in which people are connecting to, say, people who make content is very different. And we are still going about it the stodgy old way of, like, you know, putting out a trailer and hoping that it'll get places. But trailers, nobody sits and watches trailers necessarily, right? You have to pay to get your trailer to come at frequent intervals on somebody's browser. You have to pay to show your trailer even in a cinema theater. Can you imagine? When actually that should be for free, because at least the cinema hall is
paid. Yeah. That trailer in the cinema.
Yeah, if you don't attach it to another film, you have to pay for it. If I'm attached to, say, Animal, then I know that the billions of people going to see Animal will also see my trailer, right? But otherwise, I pay for it, which is bizarre, because technically, cinema theaters should be pumping all the trailers so that people want to come to watch the films. Why should have to pay to put out a trailer, right?
Because it's also beneficial that, for cinema.
Exactly. It's beneficial only to them. I mean, and to us. But yeah. So, I mean, I don't think this happens internationally. I think it's an India thing where they charge you to show your trailer. So, actually, to even make you aware that I've spent 17 years of my life making a masterpiece, it is going to cost me my kidney and, you know, probably my house as well.
I remember like in earlier, I think during my childhood, that there used to be some vans that used to come, like the recent, Aa Raha Hai, Raja Babu, Aa Raha Hai. These kind of marketing techniques that
works great, at a local level,
entire mohalla is aware that kuch aa raha hai.
I feel like literally, and I've been told that now that's actually the only way to go beyond a certain kind of you know, sort of internet user to the consumer out there is actually much more sort of localized local interventions like this. Maybe not, I wish we could do these little vans saying this, but other than that, literally there are influencers of all kinds, right? There are much more sort of, I don't know, village level, BNC town level influencers who have a dedicated audience to whom now one obviously should pay, and that's a better way to actually... If someone had told me this, I would have done my Lapata publicity or marketing like this, because my goal was to get to those two people, you know, beyond just cities, you know. But like we were talking earlier also, single screens have vanished.
With that culture of watching, especially in that lower income group, that culture of coming, going to...
It's just become too expensive for people. Film watching has to become cheaper if we want masses to come back to cinemas. It's as simple as that. As an industry, we need to do something about that. You know, it's not going to happen if we have to start pricing tickets much cheaper if we want more people in cinemas. And we have to build more screens, because people otherwise will pirate it. Why shouldn't they? They can't get to watch it. There's no cinema hall near their house for, you know, kilometers. And they can't perhaps...
But do you think there's a problem with screens? Because they are quite like...
No, not at all. For a country our size, we have less... I mean, I think we have... even America has some... Obviously, a fraction of our population and many times our number of screens. But just by comparison, like China has upwards of 90,000 screens, almost a lakh. Then soon it'll be 1 lakh screens in the country. And we have 10,000 at most.
10,000?
Yeah, at most. And of that, like half are in the south. So Hindi films, say, will have about 5,000.
Okay.
When you think of the population that of, say, even if you take children, because if you say we are talking about a U film, Where do you go to watch a film which is nearby and affordable? So, cities may be, you know, there are, I mean, I'm talking most, now we have some 20, 30 cities in our country. So, those cities you'll probably have, you know, good number of screens. But leave the city and you start to travel outside any big city. Where are your film theatres? And those film theatres will have one screen, maybe two screens. So the number of films that release on a weekend, you're constantly fighting to be in a screen, right? You're never going to be everywhere at the same time.
I think that whole idea of consumption has also changed in the completely market economy that we are living in. So maybe earlier the sources of entertainment was limited, so single screen or that community viewing became very interesting. But right now, since sources of entertainment are so much, even on your phone, there are reels, shorts, YouTube. Like my mother watches reels, shorts all the time. She don't have time for movies.
Yeah, my son.
Because of that.
Yeah.
So that whole idea of entertainment is so much that now just to go to cinema hall to consume something may not be a very,
I mean, and that too, yeah, 2 hour long thing, wow. And everybody is like ready to get their fix in 20 minutes.
So mostly it is like a package, like chalo mall chalte hain, mall mein kuch khareedenge, kuch khayenge, fir raat ko film dekhenge. So film become that consumption economy mein, it becomes one of the package.
Yeah.
So maybe like people need to think that how
it's the experience. It, sab log experience.
Or like an event film became a major thing.
This whole spectacle film. Yeah, has become the. And many people think that that is the holy grail. It's the only way to make money in cinemas.
Which your film break the that whole rule that now post pandemic there should be only event films.
Yeah.
But your film was entirely different from this kind of.
It continues to run 12th Fail, yeah. Which again was hugely successful. But and conversely, huge films have which were very very big films with marquee names have failed at the box office. So it's. In some ways, perhaps the pandemic years changed viewing habits so drastically. The fact that the convenience of being able to watch really good quality things in my own house have changed my appetite for watching lots of people like what lots of people call trash in a cinema house and paying through my nose for it, you know. So I suppose it's we'll have to do ideally both, but one of two things is one, make cinemas cheaper and cinema viewing more affordable, and two is just make better films. Just, you know, do what Malayalam cinema is doing, film after film, you know what I mean?
That also reaches to the local public.
So I mean, there's a cost ceiling in many of these states in the South is that they do not allow you to take charge beyond a certain ticket price.
Oh, really?
Yeah. There's a ticket price, I think it's in Tamil Nadu, and in fact, producers, or it was in Andhra, in fact, they tried to say that it has to be less than, I forget what, a very, very 50 rupees or something, when it was 100 rupees right now, something like that. And there's been an outcry among producers saying, look, it limits the kinds of films that we'll make. You know, if you start putting a cap on ticket prices that are so low, you know, to be able to recoup then becomes impossible. So, yeah, it's a...
Because I also remember last, I think, Art Dasbar, we went with family together and we were disappointed all the time. So, we were calculating ki itne paise lagge sabke. So, yeah. So, that also...
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So, in fact, I think this is going to be my last question. So today, Ishan, who's shooting by the way, reminded me that Payal Kapadia's film is getting screened at Cannes. That too in the competition, which is a very, very big news for...
Huge news
for the Indian cinema. Although I'm very surprised that not many people are talking about it because it's a very big... achievement, but yeah, that is the whole thing about our film discourse that became so limited. So I in fact did a podcast with Payal, and I also asked her that, especially in Indian cinema, there are very less women filmmakers. Although one of my favorite filmmakers is Sai Paranjpe from India. So we can calculate them on our fingertips.
Correct.
They are very limited filmmaker. So I was curious to understand what is the reason behind it, because also obviously there is other form of diversity as well, like in terms of caste also we can talk about it, but we can talk about the especially about the women filmmaker today. So what is the reason behind it? It is because of the from the early age, like the our society also, like they don't even see men in the film also generally, but obviously not women in the film industry because of the many reason. And how do you see, like, why is such kind of disparity, and what can be done to maybe increase diversity in all forms in future?
Interestingly, I read a report that TISS did with, did you read about that? By any chance? It's called Lights, Camera and Time for Action. And it really looks at women's representation, both on screen and behind the screen. They take a period between, I think, pre-pandemic ke 5 years, you know. And it's shocking how low the representation is and poor in terms of diversity of even women characters and the roles that they play in cinema is in Indian cinema. And I mean, traditionally, the film industry was always looked at as a place of vice, and you know how performance actually has been viewed with a moral lens for the longest time, and women have therefore been slower, I suppose, to join the industry for safety reasons or for reasons why you know, where conservative families were just not happy with women coming into the film industry. I mean, and I think a second important reason even back then, and it continues to be the case, is that there's no clear, systematic way in which one can actually enter the film industry, and there is some sort of a ladder that one climbs in a fairly understood, formatted way, where I join at X level as an AD, I learn the ropes, I can go up that ladder. It becomes very personality driven in a as an industry, and depending on how you make your way in, you find yourself in a particular food chain, you know. So each of these sort of almost, I wouldn't say bubbles, but they're sort of separate kinds of cliques or, you know, groups that operate within the film industry. And it's then a person's luck and connections and privilege and, you know, I don't know, wherewithal that they have to be able to get into one of those groups. And I think that's intimidating for most people. Where do I even start? How do I get in here, you know? And for women, most of all, because, you know, I remember when I first came to the industry and I went to, you know, I didn't know anything about the film industry. I sort of, you know, a friend's friend told me, ki, you know, XYZ person is looking for ADs. They're starting a film. Maybe they're looking for ADs. So somewhere in Varsova was the office. I went to the office and I was like, you know,
Aramnagar.
Can I, you know, I wanted to join work. So they said, aap photo dijiye. So I said, photo kai ke liye? They said, photo dijiye, aap act kaise karengi? So I said, mujhe acting nahi karni, mujhe AD banni hai. They said, kya? Like, which? So I said, nahi, mujhe kaam karna hai director ke saath. So they said, acha, acha, whatever. Naam, number likhli. Obviously, I didn't hear back. Because the idea that women were joining, and they said, I'm talking about the late 90s, was just not, it wasn't so easy to even get to a director, right? One would think it's easier now, but there are many, many more directors and many, many more production houses, but it remains very, in some ways, opaque. And as a producer myself, I find it hard because a lot of people kind of reach out to me to work with me, but there's no way to actually filter the kind of interest that comes your way. So, I mean, and women, as we know, traditionally have that many more hurdles to jump to get anywhere. Other than that, I feel it's to change it, or you know, having worked in this industry so many years, I feel that it's a place that's actually very welcoming and very equal in many ways when it comes to your skill set and you know what role you'll actually provide. For instance, editor who's a woman will not get paid less than an editor who's a man, for instance, because she's a woman. It's not been the kind of industry that discriminates in terms of pay scales for a certain skill set. Perhaps at the actor level, you know, where it becomes a big ticket, you know, kind of pay scale, paycheck, then there might be some discrimination because of what they consider to be stardom and bums on seats value. But when it comes to the regular crew, it's not discriminatory at all, in fact. And I feel it's a very safe and pretty equal industry in that sense. And the only way I think we can encourage more women or people from different caste backgrounds or people with disabilities or you know, people from LGBTQ communities, is if we actively look for them and we, as producers, decide that we are going to include them. That's the only way it'll change, is if we actually make it a rule for ourselves that we will, in our crew, we will try to be representative and try and take 50% women, trans people, everyone, you know. So I think the film industry doesn't think about these things actively. And I personally only really started thinking about it in such a practical, active way after I read the TIS report. So it's really important that this information get to producers, that actually the only way we'd be able to restore that kind of balance and get more women into filmmaking is if we recruit more women and we decide that we are not going to, and when we are writing, especially, we start writing in more women. I mean, I've got so many scripts that have come to me which have paper thin women characters, and or just only women characters and paper thin men, you know. And often it's the case of sitting down and saying, can't this person just be, you know, a woman, or this person be, you know, stop being, you know, so predictable in our you know, in our writing also. Start being a little more creative and finding ways to include the stories of people we don't see well represented is, I think, the only way forward.
In fact, that is also like the representation of women by many male filmmakers who want to, like, let's say, you know, break the rules, or they want to write women who are powerful. So in their image, the powerful women is just
holding a gun,
cigarette and black glasses.
Chashma, yeah.
So you don't see them, like, you just see them in a very tokenistic, or that
correct.
That is also a very male perspective, what a strong woman can be.
Exactly.
We don't get to see their own, their existential state of mind or their psychological behavior, how they are navigating. No, they're just a badass.
Yeah.
Image. So that is also, yeah, very predictable and
so true.
Boring,
yeah,
representation.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
that is also there. But in general, like, the whole entry into film industry is very mysterious.
It is.
Like,
it
nobody knows why. Like, you enter and you go to Aramnagar. Aramnagar is the place where you get disturbed,
yeah,
basically. Ironically, titled Aramnagar.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I also remember when I came here in 2000, I think, 12 or 11, I was completely clueless what to do here. So, I roamed around the city for 4-5 months, and then I went back and joined JNU, where I got completely relaxed because, you know, everything is so cheap there and atmosphere is good. So yeah, it is mysterious, still
it
mysterious
is,
for
it
people.
It continues to be. I mean, and even,
yeah,
for Kindling, for instance, I'm really interested in, you know, maybe at some stage working with a lot of different kinds of filmmakers to make work. But it just comes at you in our country as a barrage of requests at one go. Like, I've got so many scripts to read that for the next 2 years we'll be reading. It's because I actually created a system. I said, please write to this email called hello@kindling.co.in, which I'm saying on your podcast also, so that people don't DM me. I'm constantly being barraged, but it's hello@kindling.co.in. People write there, and on that email auto response, it says, send it in an SWA registered form, or, you know, such and such, so that we can also file it.
But do you read scripts from that email?
We are starting to read. We've only just finished this film. I mean, I'm barely out of promotions and marketing of Lapata Ladies. We've just delivered to Netflix less than a month ago. It came on Netflix, you know. So my life is still a bit tied up with it, but we will get around to it. I have, you know, accumulated like 10 years of writing work of my own that I'm hoping to get made. And I've only been producing for other people in the last 10 years, right? So the greed is really to be able to make more work a little more quickly, so that, you know, that frustration I can sort of...
And when can we watch the next film by you?
I'm heading out to write, so I'm hoping very soon. I'm very excited to try different genres. So this one is kind of supernatural,
oh, wow,
horror genre.
Really?
So,
superb.
Yeah, we'll see. I'm hoping soon.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you so much, Kiran, for taking out the time. I know you are extremely busy right now with so many interviews and so many events that you are currently attending. So thank you so much for taking out the time for our small podcast.
It's
really, really
my absolute pleasure. I'm a big fan of your podcast. I'm delighted to be featured on it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So this was today's podcast. If you like it, then please do consider supporting us on Patreon, Buy Me a Coffee and other mediums. All the links are mentioned in the description box. Please do check them out. Thank you so much for watching this video.